Hello all, I welcome you to the today's learning on vehicle performance. It is the unit number 6 of our subject fundamental of automotive system. Now whenever we talked about this vehicle performance, the study is based on these two things, the acceleration capacity of the vehicle and the control capabilities of the vehicle. The acceleration capacity depends on the performance of engine, the design of transmission system, the suspension optimization, weight and the dimension of the vehicle, and the aerodynamics of the vehicle. The control capabilities depends on the steering mechanism, man-eat subsystem, suspension system, the transmission and final drive system, and tires and the braking system. We have studied the effect of all these subsystems of an automobile, say transmission system, suspension system, the tires and brake in a previous session. So how this will contribute to the overall performance of a vehicle, of the vehicle. These are the broad parameters to assess the performance of a vehicle. Okay, even whenever we are going to buy a vehicle or whenever we are going to assess the performance of a vehicle, these are three main parameters. Okay. The first one is the reliability, we also call it dependability of the vehicle. A reliable vehicle is one which requires very few repairs during the service life. Okay, and this reliability has improved in recent years due to schedules or preventive maintenance programs. Okay, so nowadays people are very much aware about the preventive and scheduled maintenance. Whenever we are going to buy a vehicle, it may be a car or a bike, the manufacturer are going to provide us a book, a service book kind of thing, in which the duration of service is already mentioned in terms of days or in terms of kilometers of use. The second one is the durability. Okay, durability, it depends upon, it talks about the strength, the sturdiness under the service condition, different service conditions like the load variation, the characteristics of road, of course the environment conditions. Okay, we all know the loading condition may be different during the use of the vehicle, so how the vehicle will respond to the varying load condition, and of course the road conditions are also not uniform throughout the use, so the characteristic of road is also a parameter under the durability, and the environmental condition. Okay, we all know the systems and subsystems are to be assessed for this environmental condition also. We have talked about in the session of tires and wheels that the tread pattern of tire in the northern part of the country is different than the remaining part of the country because of the nature of hilly areas, hilly road condition. Okay, same way in the area of coastal region, the more weightage is given to the rusting characteristics of the vehicle body and the other part. So they used to have the layer of anti-rust chemicals on it. And the last one and the most important is the economy. Okay, we all prefer whatever is our vehicle is performing, but we must concentrate on the economical part also. Okay. Whenever we talked about economy, we prefer that our vehicle must have the lesser amount of operating cost, that is for the fuel, say lubricants and other consumable things, and spare parts, etc. Okay, so it is good for our pockets also. Now these are some sample data, the design and performance data of a vehicle. See, in this we have considered the very famous vehicle of Toyota Innova, the petrol and diesel and version, and these are the say different version of the vehicle as per the specification. Okay, this first part is related to the dimension of a vehicle. Okay, length, width, height, wheelbase, the track, weight of the vehicle. This curve weight is the weight of the vehicle without considering the load of passenger and the luggage, the ground clearance, the minimum turning radius, the seating capacity of the vehicle, and the fuel tank capacity. The engine parameters are the type of engine, the arrangement of cams and all, and the technologies being used, the displacement, engine displacement, okay, it depends, it is been calculated depends upon the value of bore in stroke, okay, the bore diameter and stroke length, the volume is this displacement volume, the number of cylinders, number of valve arrangement, and the maximum possible power at certain speed and maximum possible torque which will be supplied by this vehicle at once again a certain amount of speed. Then we are having the important ratio, that is called power to weight ratio and torque to weight ratio, okay. The power available per the consumption of unit fuel, that is specific fuel consumption, and the drivetrain, rear wheel drive, the transmission system, then the details about the suspension and the suspension subsystems, the steering type, the front suspension, rear suspension, tire size, and the brakes, okay, and ultimately the fuel efficiency for the different condition, CT and highway, and the tested by the ARAI, okay, Automotive Research Association of India. They used to certify the vehicle manufactured in India and to be sold in India, the amount of fuel consumed by the vehicle in the normal condition. So this is about the sample data of a vehicle. This kind of seats are available for the different manufacturer and different models. Now the study of the motion of a vehicle. So as per is our syllabus and content is concerned, we will focus on this much part, okay, the power and torque developed by the engine, the tractive effort, the gearbox ratio, the power at driving wheels, and the different kind of resistance to the vehicle motion, and the power to weight ratio. So let us talk about the first one, power and torque developed by the engine, okay. So this is the working of the IC engine. In this animation you can see the working of a typical CI engine, compression ignition engine. So the fuel will be the diesel, okay. Say let us wait for the intake stroke. This is the intake stroke where air will come inside the cylinder, then this is the compression, then the fuel will be injected, and the power, generation of power, and ultimately the exhaust, okay. This is we have studied in the previous semester. Now the power stroke is the stroke, or it is the process during which the torque is being produced at the crankshaft, okay. This is the power and torque developed by the engine. See, the torque developed by the engine is transmitted through the drive line to the road wheels to propel the vehicle, okay. The sequence will be the crankshaft to the clutch to the gearbox, and then to the propeller shaft, and then to the differential, and finally to the axle shaft and to the wheels, okay. And this power developed by the engine is calculated based on this equation, that is this BP means brake power is equal to 2 pi n t by 60,000. If you want to measure it in terms of kilowatt, this n is the engine speed and this is the torque developed by the engine. This brake power is calculated or say measured with the help of dynamometers. There are many kind of dynamometers that we have studied in the previous semester, okay. So any kind of dynamometer can be used during for the appropriate condition, and you can find out the value of this brake power. Let us recall our knowledge about this brake power also and the integrated power. There are three kind of power, okay. The first one is the integrated power, that is known as IP. The second one is this brake power, and the third one is called friction power, okay. This integrated power is the power available at the piston, okay, just at the end of power stroke. And this brake power is the power available to the crankshaft after considering all the losses, okay. And this FP is the friction power. This is power lost for different kind of friction at the different kind of processes. So the power available at the crankshaft, it is this brake power, okay. Now in this particular chart, please observe this chart. On the x-axis we are having the speed, okay, in terms of RPM, horizontal axis. On the vertical axis, in the left hand side, we are having the torque, Newton into meter. The right hand side axis, we are having the power in terms of kilowatt. Now first observe this red color curve, okay. This is about the power. The power is increasing, okay, as the speed will increase. up till some value, it reaches whenever it reaches the maximum value, after then it will decline, because the suction is not available after some amount of speed, so power will decrease. The same thing will happen with the torque also. Torque will increase up to certain limit and then it will start to decrease. Now this play will be between the torque and power will be governed by the gearbox. So this is the importance of gearbox. What is the function of gearbox? How this gearbox is being used to play with the value of torque and power, that is we have seen in the unit of the transmission system. Now the tractive effort. Okay, so before tractive effort, the torque available at the contact between driving wheels and the road is called tractive torque. Okay, it is denoted by capital TW or a wheel torque, a torque available at the wheel. Okay, it is been calculated with the help of this equation. Okay, so TW is equal to gearbox ratio multiplied by the overall transmission efficiency multiplied by the engine torque. Okay, this engine torque can be given by the previous equation that we have used to find out the brake power. From that we can get the value of this torque and we can use it over here. Okay, now the tractive effort, we all know torque is equal to force into the radius. Okay, so from that this tractive effort is a kind of force only, that F is equal to torque divided by the radius. This torque is the torque available at the wheel and this radius is the radius of the driving wheel. So from this we will get the value of tractive effort. Okay, so tractive effort or tractive force is the force required at the engine wheels to propel the vehicle. Okay, if you want to move the vehicle, so this kind of tractive force is required. Now this tractive force or effort or the thrust provided by the engine at driving wheels varies at different speed and with different gear position. This we have seen in the unit of gearbox transmission system. Now this is the relation between engine speed and wheel speed. Okay, so let us consider the small v is the linear velocity or the speed of the vehicle in meter per minutes. This RW is the radius of wheel in meter and this NW, capital NW, is the speed of driving wheel in terms of RPM. Okay, now from the relation between the linear speed and angular speed, V is equal to R omega. Okay, so this V is equal to RW omega, so RW into 2 pi NW. We all know omega is equal to 2 pi N by 60. So this is in terms of minute, so we can consider only 2 pi NW, 2 pi N. Okay, so from this NW is equal to, okay, NW is equal to V upon 2 pi RW. So RW 2 into pi, and this is nothing but the vehicle speed to the wheel circumference. Okay, circumference is equal to 2 pi R. So this is nothing but the circumference of the wheel. And the gear ratio is equal to speed of engine to the speed of wheel. So we can put the value of speed of wheel in this equation and we will get this relation that NE is equal to G into V RW 2 into pi. So gear ratio into the speed of the vehicle divided by the radius of wheel into 2 into pi. So this is the relation between the engine speed and the vehicle speed. Now the power available at the driving wheels. See, power available at the driving wheels generally it is in the range of 60% to 75% of the total power produced or total power available at the crankshaft. Okay, because of there are some amount of losses, there are various type of losses which will take place between the engine and the driving wheels. So these losses are, so the first loss is the power loss due to the friction of piston, bearings and gears in the engine. Okay, so this friction will contribute to the power loss. The second loss, it is also due to the friction, but the power loss from clutch to drive wheels due to friction in clutch. Okay, the friction within the elements, clutch, gearbox, universal joints, final drive, differential and between tires and ground. So this is the friction which will contribute to the loss and ultimately the transmission line loss. So the power lost in transmission of power from engine to road wheels will reflect in the transmission efficiency, eta C. Say we have seen in the eta t in this equation. See eta t. See overall transmission efficiency. Okay. Now coming back to the resistance to the motion of a vehicle. Okay, this is the one of the most important thing. Okay, for the performance of a vehicle. Now, whenever the vehicle is moving, and it will be opposed by various kind of forces. These forces are known as resistances. So, resistances are the opposing forces to the vehicle motion. Okay, to keep this vehicle moving, a driving force or attractive effort equal to the sum of all this resistance. If we make the total of this resistance, okay, so this total of resistance should be equal to the attractive effort applied by the vehicle. Okay. When this attractive force will exceed, it is more in terms of this sum of all resistance, the vehicle will accelerate. Okay, and if this F is less than this sum of resistance, the vehicle will decelerate. So it will increase the speed of the vehicle, and this will decrease the speed of the vehicle. So there are three main forces which will oppose the motion. Okay, the rolling resistance, wind resistance, or you can say air resistance. You can say air drag, okay, then this gradient resistance. So let us start with this first one, that is the rolling resistance. Now this rolling resistance, it is mainly due to the friction between wheel tires and road surface. Okay, it will depends upon these factors, say load on each wheel, type of the tire tread, wheel inflation pressure, and nature of road resistance. Nature of road surface. It is generally measured in kg or newton, and it is expressed as kg per ton or newton per ton of a vehicle weight, or as a percentage of the vehicle weight. Sometimes it is also denoted by the, say, this much percentage of the rolling resistance will be there for this much amount of weight. Now this rolling resistance will be given by, say, RR, rolling resistance RR is equal to KR into W. Okay, this KR is the coefficient of rolling resistance. Okay, and this W is equal to total weight of this vehicle. Okay, now let us understand the concept between this rolling resistance, how this this phenomena occurs. Okay, say in previous relation we have seen that rolling is resistance proportional to the KR. Okay, rolling resistance is proportional to KR. It is coefficient of rolling resistance. But it does not explicitly show any variation with speed, load, torque, surface roughness, diameter, the tire inflation and the wear, because the value of KR itself take care about these factors. Okay, that is why it is not shown in the relation. These factors is already been taken care in the value of this KR. So we can see this relation, the rolling resistance is directly proportional to the vehicle weight, but actually it is not directly proportional to the vehicle weight. These parameters, these factor are more contributing in the value of this rolling resistance. Please observe this figure. Okay, in this there are main physical causes of a rolling resistance. See, this is the wheel. Okay, and this is the tire. See, this is the direction of the travel. In this direction the vehicle is moving. Now when this part of the wheel, okay, when this part of the wheel make the contact with the road, there will be certain bending of the thread will happen. Okay, so there will be a bending, and here there will be compression or there will be a sharing with this, and once again the bending will be there. Okay, and this kind of rotation will be there. Okay, so this deformation will contribute around 80 to 95% of the energy loss. Okay, we can call it a hysteresis loss also, because when this thread or this portion, this surface will contact with the road surface, there will be a generation of friction, and friction will be converted into the heat. Okay, and because of this heat there will be a loss of energy. This is hysteresis loss, and this shear, and here once again the bending. Okay, and there will be some amount of very less slippage will be there, and this is less than 5%. And when this wheel is rotating, there will be some aerodynamic drag also, and this drag is generally 0 to 15%. Okay, so this is about the rolling resistance. This is the phenomena, or everything will happens over here. This will contribute the 80 to 95% of the energy loss. The next is wind or air resistance, and we can denote it by R subscript A, RA. It is due to the striking of moving vehicle with a dense medium. Okay, this dense medium is generally air or say wind. Okay, it depends upon the following factors: shape and size of vehicle body, that is the aerodynamics, the velocity of air, and the speed of vehicle. Okay, if you find out the value of this air resistance, it is given by RA. RA is equal to coefficient of air resistance, KA, into the projected frontal area. Okay, frontal area of the vehicle, capital A, into the square of vehicle speed. So how this vehicle speed is more dominant in the value of this air resistance. Okay, the value of KA for base streamline car, which is having the good amount of aerodynamics, is around 0.00235. For average car, it is in the range of 0.0032, and for the buses and trucks, it is in the range of 0.0046. Okay, now see the nature of this resistance with respect to the vehicle speed. Okay, first of all, let us see about the projected frontal area, how this area is being visualized. Okay, so this is the car, and if we see from the front, there will be some projection on the vertical plane, and this is called frontal projected area. Okay, now see, this is the vehicle speed on the horizontal axis, and this is the resistance force opposing the motion in terms of Newton. Okay, generally the rolling resistance is constant, it varies with very less, it depends upon the speed. Okay, so it is generally a flat kind of curve. Okay, then for the low air resistance, the least value of this air constant, okay, air resistance constant, and this is the high air resistance constant. See, this curve is very, okay, this, observe this slope. Okay, slope is very high in case of this high air resistance vehicle. Okay, the performance is largely impacted because of the aerodynamics or the frontal area of the vehicle. Okay, if we talk about the air resistance, see, these are some profile, okay, CFD analysis, CFD profiles of the vehicle. Okay, this kind of analysis is being done with the help of CFD type softwares. Okay, these are the street lines. Okay, the normal car, the good aerodynamic profile. Okay, the sports car, and see the truck. Okay, there will be some disturbance of the street lines. Okay, this will cause the more amount of air resistance. The last one is the gradient resistance, RG. Okay, it is due to the steepness of the road gradient. Okay, because of this slope, this resistance is mainly because of the slope. It depends upon the vehicle weight and road gradient. It does not depend upon the vehicle speed. Okay, the component of the weight along the road surface try to resist the motion. See, if you observe this figure, okay, say this is the slope. Okay, this angle is theta with respect to the horizontal direction. Okay, suppose this is the CG of the vehicle, and the weight will be always in the vertically downward direction. Okay, so this is one component, the cos theta, W cos theta, and the one of these component is parallel to the road surface, W sin theta. This is perpendicular to the road surface, and this is parallel to the road surface. So this component of weight will try to resist the motion. Okay, vehicle is moving in this direction. Okay, see, in this direction, it will try to resist the motion, and this is equal to W sin theta. So gradient resistance, RG, is equal to W into sin theta, where W is the weight of vehicle and theta is the angle of inclination. Now see total resistance. So if we consider the effect of all these three resistance, when the vehicle is moving up the gradient, the total resistance will be given by the rolling resistance plus air resistance and the gradient resistance. But when it is moving along the level road, okay, there is no need to consider the gradient resistance. Your equation will become RR plus RA. Okay, now once again observe this graph. This is for particular vehicle. On the horizontal axis, this is the vehicle velocity. on the vertical axis, these are the forces. Okay, now see, this green line is the rolling resistance, generally a flat kind of line. Okay, generally the flat kind of line, it doesn't depend upon the vehicle velocity, vehicle speed. This blue line is the air resistance, or you can say aerodynamic drag, aerodynamic drag for this particular figure. This is nothing but the air resistance, and this red line is the total, say total cumulative effect of both this resistance. So we can see the aerodynamic drag has the larger impact on the total resistance. So the shape of the vehicle, okay, aerodynamics of the vehicle is very much of importance to assess the performance of a vehicle. The next parameter is the power to weight ratio. Okay, it is very, very much important parameter. An automobile's performance much depends upon its power to weight ratio. Okay, this is nothing but the how much amount of power is being developed by the vehicle depends upon the weight of this engine. Okay, the best performance can be achieved by keeping the weight of vehicle down to a minimum and installing the engines of higher BHP. So our ultimate target to increase the power to weight ratio is to maintain this weight as minimum as possible and increase the power capacity of the vehicle. Okay, higher the power to weight ratio, better will be its hill climbing abilities and the maximum speed, and that is better the acceleration. Okay, a well designed streamlined car having higher power to weight ratio registers a low fuel consumption at any given speed. Okay, so good power to weight ratio will contribute towards the higher climbing abilities, maximum speed, good acceleration, and of course the low fuel consumption of the vehicle. Okay, the progressive increase in power to weight ratio has brought the improvement in the performance of an automobile. See how? See, we want to minimize the weight. Okay, this weight is considerably reduced by the use of lighter material and improved method of chassis and body construction. Okay, so lighter, see, we have studied this in the unit of that chassis and body, different types of body and chassis and frame is used to minimize the overall weight of the vehicle without affecting the strength of the vehicle. Okay, so this advancement has contributed to lower down the weight, overall weight of the vehicle. Now the power output of the vehicle has been increased by using aluminum and magnesium alloys as a part of engine systems. See, improved piston ring, cylinder and combustion chamber design, increased compression ratio due to use of aluminum alloys, pistons and cylinder heads, better engine balancing, lubrication and cooling systems, fuels of higher octane values, balanced fuel supply and correct ignition. So these are the parameters in which we are having good advancement in terms of technology. Okay, so we are able to provide more power output of to the engine with the same engine size. So compact engine can also provide good power output. Okay, and the weight is being reduced by the different methods of fabrication of chassis body. Okay, so this is how we are able to improve the power to weight ratio of a vehicle. Okay, see, next there is the product development cycle of an automobile, how this automobile as a product is being developed. Okay, these are the different stages. So the first stage is the objective, or say you can say the requirements. So in this one, people will gather the product marketing and support requirement, what is the need of this particular vehicle for that particular segment. So this kind of data will be collected in this stage, and the next one is the planning and design stage, the complete high level requirement plan, the technical design document, the design and planning will be done in this in particular stage, planning and design. And then the development, the product development commences. Okay, there will be laying out of the assembly lines, procurement of the components, okay, the manufacturing of different kind of elements and subsystems. Okay, this is being done in this development stage. Then the prototype development, okay, sample is being produced, being manufactured, to take the review of the product, the early customer agreement, how it will look and how it will behave. Then there will be first article, the first product, the customer verification and acceptance. Okay, then ultimately the last is the mass production. Okay, the vehicle will be produced in good quantity, and we can have after that the product management system, okay, to manage the further performance or say working of this automobile after the sales. Okay, one more chart is there, one more diagram is there. This is the product development cycle. Okay, the same way, the concept design, then the engineering design, design of different components. Okay, then deciding the layout and packaging of this instrument, okay, and the systems, then the system engineering, okay, the assembly of different kind of system to make a complete vehicle, then the powertrain engineering, the requirement of engine, the capacity of engine and the type of engine, okay, then the integration of vehicle, integration of all subsystems, and ultimately there will be one prototype. Okay, then testing of this prototype, and then validating the performance parameters, and ultimately we are having the product ready for the mass production. Okay, thank you all.